also my pleasure to be here in this talk. In this building where I had my exams as an undergraduate student some 40 years ago, I think. Correct. But now I'm with a laser laboratory in Göttingen, Germany, and today I'd like to give you, let's try to say, a summary of the activities of our laboratory dedicated to nanoscale photonics. And while the mission of the institute is to perform application-oriented basic research on the field of lasers and laser application, and also to promote technology transfer from science to industry. And this is done by contract research, educational training, and scientific consulting. And the institute has four sections, four departments, all addressing different scientific topics. The first one is the Department of Optical Nanoscopy. The second is optics short wavelength department, photonic sensor technology, and short pulse nanostructures department, which I'm responsible for. But in the following slide, I'd like to tell you about the activities, what they do, and I would like to start with the optical and nanoscale department. Well, here the goal is to perform optical microscopy on a nanosecond scale. And so we know that there are microscopy techniques with nanometer resolution, like electron microscopy and other techniques. But the point is to operate such a microscope in the visible range, because it has great advantage, especially in biological tissue. And just let's look at the history of microscopy. So up to about 1700, it was limited by the available magnification of lenses. 100 years later, it was limited by aberration of the lenses. And again, about 100 years later, Ernst Abbe in Jena postulated what is written on a memorial stone in Jena, that the resolution of an optical microscope is limited by the wavelength of light and the numerical aperture of the optics used, which is certainly limited. So that all previous limitations were technical, but this is a physical limitation. And everyone thought there is nothing to do it better. And this means that the limit is somewhere at about 200 nanometers for visible light, and no better resolution can be achieved. Until very recently, these three gentlemen developed new techniques to break the diffraction limit. They showed that you can do it better. And they were awarded the Nobel Prize in 2014, 4 years ago. And we are extremely proud that this gentleman, Stefan Hill, is one of the directors of our institute. So his invention dates back to 1994, where he postulated that you can break the diffraction limit of microscopes with a so-called stimulated emission depletion fluorescence microscope. So you need fluorescence, and the technique to use is stimulated emission depletion. So how does it work? You need fluorescence, either the tissue, you observe proteins emit fluorescent light, or you have to add some fluorescent dyes to the species you are investigating. And then you use fluorescent. The setup itself is pretty simple. You have an excitation beam, focus it down to the minimal spot you can achieve. This is the diffraction limit spot, as Abbe postulated more than 100 years ago. And then you detect the fluorescence. There is no way to distinguish between these parts. No way. If they are within this diffraction limit, it's not. And well, the fluorescence, how does it work? So the excitation excites the molecules from the ground state to the first excited state. And then they decay down to the ground state by emitting a photon with a typical fluorescence light, like a few nanoseconds. And this is what you detect. So the idea is to keep some features, some molecules, fluorescent molecules dark. How can we do that? So the idea is to add the second beam to the system at the wavelength which matches the fluorescent wavelength of the molecule. And this beam can induce a stimulated emission. So we can force the molecules to decay from the excited state down to the ground state by emitting a photon by stimulated emission, traveling in that direction. But the detection occurs in this direction. The detection of fluorescence is in this direction. If we add a phase plate to this beam, so that we modulate the intensity distribution of that beam, so that it has a donut shape, like indicated here. And if we start increasing the intensity of this donut-shaped beam, then what's going on is first we obtain this type of image with a classical resolution. And by increasing the intensity here up to this level, then this beam forces all these molecules to emit a photon by a stimulated emission. So they are being returned back to the ground state and they cannot emit any fluorescent light anymore. So we do not detect the fluorescence from these molecules. They are switched into a dark state. By further increasing the intensity, you can just switch more and more molecules outside the central region into a dark state. And at a really high intensity, there are only very few molecules at the very center of the thermal chain, which emit fluorescent light, which you detect, and accordingly your resolution increases. And the way you record such an image is simply just scan the donut-shaped beam profile across the sample, and at each coordinate, just record the fluorescent light. Map it out there, and you obtain the high resolution image. So this is the basis of the scheme, and that was a great invention. And then the following years, very important discoveries were made with this TED microscopy, that's the name of the technique, in molecular biology. And these were reported in renowned journals like Science and Nature, and led to a better understanding of basic molecular processes in living cells. And the technique was first commercialized in 2007 by the German company Leica. And then in the meantime, nowadays, there are more commercial systems on the market. And just to give you an impression of the increase in resolution you obtain with that technique compared to high-end standard fluorescence microscopy. So this is the best image you can obtain with standard microscopy, and if you switch to standard microscopy, so this is what you obtain. Or if you look at ligand chain, this is the increasing resolution more than a normal time. Or if you just look at human neurons, this is the resolution you can obtain with this microscopy technique. In the meantime, certainly the technique has been improved so that three-dimensional recordings can be made at high speed, movies can be made, and even living cells can be examined with resolution, spatial resolution that's on the range of about 10 nanometers. Well, so great success, and then I'd like to switch to the second department, which is optics and short wavelengths. So this department is dealing with metrology, beam in optics characterization, exotic wavelengths, so in deep ultraviolet, extreme ultraviolet, and X-ray spectral ranges. And one application of this metrology technique would be the recording of thermal lensing in optics, in industrial optics. So nowadays, there are lasers available on the market delivering extremely high power levels. And if you have an extremely high power beam, and if you just put any optics in the beam, even the smallest residual absorption in the optics leads to heating, which results in refractive exchange, expansion, stress. So eventually, there is a waveform deformation, which you obtain in the end. And this is something which deteriorates the success of application. Therefore, there is a need to characterize the shape of the phase front. And this can be done by a special wavefront sender based on the Hartmann-Schaff principle, where an arbitrary phase front falls on a two-dimensional array of lenses, creating a 2D array of foci. And this is analyzed with a camera system. And from the coordinates of these foci, you can reconstruct the original phase front. And this is what was developed in our lab. Device with extremely high sensitivity, and this is just a test measurement setup showing the capability of the device. If you just take a flat optics, a quartz sample, high purity quartz, and if you apply a very high power beam, which we sent through with, normally you would expect that there is no absorption, but still there is some. Very. And this can be recorded and tested and measured by a test beam with a Hartmann-Schaff wavefront sensor. And this is the measurement results. This is the reconstructed wavefront measured here at that point by switching on and off the heating beam in real time with about 1 second resolution. And what I want to point out is that the sensitivity of this technique is to measure wavefront deformation on the order of lambda over 10,000. So lambda is the wavelength of light. In just 1/10,000, this tiny portion of the wavefront distortion can be measured with this technique. And this can evidently be used not only for just test specimens like plane optics, but complex flat field optics or whatever optics. Industry for whites, and certainly certain analysis can be performed showing low aberrations of the optics. And this is very valuable input for optics manufacturers, just to look at these deformations and design the optics so that it can be optimized. A completely different technique this department uses is compact tabletop laser-induced lambda source, also for diagnostic purposes. In this case, different gases are streaming out of the pulse nozzle, and an infrared high-powered laser beam is focused into the gas stream, creating here plasma. And depending on the gas you apply, you obtain radiation in the extreme ultraviolet or in the XUV range. So this is what the setup looks like. Tabletop device. And if you, for instance, take, let's say, nitrogen and select this line at about somewhat less than 3 nanometers, then you can realize a tabletop soft X-ray microscope, which we built up in our lab. So it's, the footprint is less than 2 square meters. It's a very compact device, operating in the so-called water window, so somewhere between 2 and 4 nanometers, where the water is transparent and carbon absorbs so that organ tissue can be imaged with high contrast. And this very compact device is capable of recording these images. So mineral-based material plasma source will be to perform so-called NEXAP spectroscopy. So this is an abbreviation for near-edge X-ray absorption fine structure spectroscopy. So what's going on here? Let's look at the energy diagram of complex molecules. So these represent the energy diagram of atoms, and if we apply this soft X-ray radiation, and if we excite an inner shell electron, then we can create an excitation up to a level which is just slightly below the continuum, the ionization level. And there are unoccupied orbitals here, which are characteristic of the molecular bonds. So that you can trace not only atoms with this technique, but you can, these fine structures, this represents a fingerprint for molecules. If you just take an organic molecule, then this fine structure, the absorption edge, it serves as a fingerprint, and you can identify these molecules. And this is a spectrum we recorded in our lab compared to synchrotron data, which is the normal use for such measurements. So just imagine, this is a 1 square meter device in the lab. And now, this way, you can perform for molecular biology just measurements on these lipid bilayers, which are major components of all cell membranes. You can look at the constituents of these, and you can identify various constituents, and then look at the functioning of these membranes, and look for some diseases which, in which case, some of these constituents are missing, for instance. Okay, so these are the activities of that department, and I'm going to switch to the third department, photonic sensor technology. They do environmental research, life sciences, security research, all that with spectroscopy techniques, so that's the common feature of all that stuff. And spectroscopy, in this case, involves infrared absorption spectroscopy, Raman spectroscopy, or fluorescence spectroscopy, covering the entire range, spectral range from infrared to ultraviolet. And there are various projects they run. One of them is to look at the CO2 emission of spark ignition engines, for instance, compressed natural gas engines, which is just a new generation engine as a competitive technology against electromobility. And in this case, car manufacturers need a manual equipment to determine the air fuel ratio in the combustion chamber and the intake manifold in order to reduce the CO2 contact. And what they would like to have is measurement data, which is crank angle result, so that during just one cycle, at each position, at each crank angle, they would like to have this ratio. And how can you do that? In this case, the method would be infrared spectroscopy. There you make use of molecular vibrations, which change the dipole moment. And if you take, for example, CO2, look at vibration. If you look at various vibration modes of this molecule, then there are some very symmetric vibrations, which are not very useful for this technique, because no infrared absorption, they cannot be excited with infrared radiation. But all vibrations that are asymmetric, and there are some vibration modes for all these species, can be used. So, as you see here, all important constituents of such a combustion process have an infrared absorption trace, and you can use this technique. shown here again. There's a fiber, there's a cavity, it's cage, there's a mirror, sending the beam back, and the same fiber is used for detecting the signal. And you can then apply infrared absorption spectroscopy to measure the properties of the gas mixture in the combustion chamber or in the intake molecule. And the test motor is set up in our laboratory, so this is what it looks like. The lab device is an engine. And in collaboration with this Göttingen-based company, building these modified spark plugs and the measurement device, the results are very successful. Actually, we can measure the lambda value, which is the air fuel ratio, with a high accuracy, high reproducibility, and at every crank angle with a high resolution. And this is extremely valuable information for car manufacturers because they can develop their engines further so that they obtain better results, and that contributes to reduce CO2 emission. Well, a further topic would be just to look at fireplaces, because it's known that wood burning fireplaces also contribute to air pollution because the smoke contains toxic particulate matter, and this is harmful to the environment and human health. And only in Germany there are over 60 million fireplaces, and there's a necessity to control the exhaust gases. And today, the measurement techniques are not comfortable, and they do not provide the sufficient accuracy for instance, CO2 emission. It's only calculated, but not directly measured. Therefore, there is a need for such technique, ideally for the simultaneous measurement of CO and CO2. And this department in our laboratory is working on that, and there are extremely promising initial results. And with, again, using this infrared absorption spectroscopy technique in a wavelength range 4 to 5 microns, it looks that it will work to make perform this simultaneous measurement, and there are negotiations with companies to commercialize the technology. And the last application of this department I would like to show you is to monitor pharmaceutical drug content in drinking water by laser-induced fluorescence. So, in this case, an ultraviolet laser pulse is coupled into the water sample to be measured, and another fiber transports the detected fluorescent signal into a detection system where not only the fluorescent spectrum is captured, but also the fluorescent decay time is measured. So, it's a time result. Spectral measurement device, and if there is no additive in this case, so it's pure water, then what they count is a round signal of the water, and this is an artifact of the device at twice that wavelength, so no fluorescent signal. If you add some tiny quantity of vitamin D, for instance, then you obtain a strong fluorescent signal, and the wavelength range and the fluorescence decay time is characteristic of that drug. And if you add some more drugs, then it's getting more complex. And what you can do is that you can take a lot of constituents, a lot of drugs, measure all these characteristic spectra with the corresponding fluorescence decay times, just set up a data bank, and then afterwards measure all samples and trace it back. And it can be extremely useful not only for the pharmaceutical industry, but also for water supply companies, because the technique physical, which I'm personally responsible for, short pulses and nanostructures. Here in this department, we focus primarily on materials processing for production technologies, in particular surface processing with lasers, with ultra-short pulse lasers. And we address all aspects of this complex process chain. So we develop the lasers to provide pulses which are best suited for the regarded applications. We develop beam delivery schemes to bring the photons from the source to the workpiece in an ideal manner. We look at the light matter interaction here on an atomic scale to understand the involved processes, and eventually we'll look at the application, the specific applications, and develop all that technique in a way that we provide the best results for the regarded application. And the major focus is placed on the fabrication of periodic nanostructures on surfaces that give rise to a role of surprising functionalities, like the lotus effect, which is well known from the lotus leaf, with super hydrophobic property, so that you can fabricate self-cleaning surfaces. Or the optical functionality can be used to make holographic design elements or refractive security features, and even cell growth engineering you can perform, because depending on the topology of these structures, cells, cell adhesion on surfaces can be strongly modified. So just to give you an impression of how these structures can look like, what we fabricated in our lab on different materials, is just should tell you that we achieved a pretty high precision and resolution with our technique, reproducibility, and there is a vast variety of various topologies we can realize. And we also work on the beam transport techniques. We use not only well-known arrangements where one uses the diffractive optical element or mass projection, very well-known techniques, but we also develop our own beam transport schemes based on various interference techniques. And then I'd like to show you some applications of these techniques. In this case, we focus on set cleaning surfaces. How can we do that? In this case, we apply a diffractive optical element, which is known to be able to create virtually any arbitrary intensity distribution in a certain plane in space. And if the design is element so that a two-dimensional array of intensity maximizer obtained, then we can use it to drill a huge number of holes with our laser beam simultaneously. And then if we apply replication, this can be stainless steel, for instance, and if we replicate it to a plastic part, then the negative of the structure is obtained with showing this topology. And this has a super hydrophobic property, as shown here. So in this way, we can obtain self-cleaning surfaces. The next application will be to use the optical properties of the periodic nanostructures to create holographic design elements. For that, we use a so-called grating interferometer device consisting of two transition gratings with two different periods. In this case, the ratio is 3:1. And it can be shown that using this very simple device, there is a specific plane in space where a perfect interference pattern is obtained regardless of the wavelength of the light we use here, and also regardless of the angle of the radiation we use here. So actually what you can do is you can use lasers with very poor coherence properties, and you can use a scanning system, and still you obtain perfect interference pattern there. And this is where you place your workplace. And this is the workplace, the stainless steel sample. And then we can write any arbitrary patterns with diffractive features. There are some more examples of that. This is the symbol of the city of Göttingen coming from this statue in the central place of the city. And this is just how we manufacture that with our laser system. So we scan across the sample and write these diffractive patterns showing this rainbow image. And as I said, this can not only be used for design elements, but we can also use this technology to create security features. As you know, well, these are well established in credit cards and banknotes. There are these diffractive features or holograms. They are easily visible, made by the naked eye, machine readable and fraud resistant. So it's very nice. The idea would be to use them also for plastic parts. Why? Evidently, also for fraud prevention, traceability, and for the attractive design. But how could we do that? So one possibility would be just to place holographic stickers on that. But certainly this is not durable, can be removed, and probably also too expensive. Neither of I think of each plastic part is evidently too expensive. So our choice would be to apply replication, injection molding, and then for that we have to write these defective structures on the molds. And this is what we developed together with a Swiss company in Unica. So the idea is to write the defective features on the mold. Then after injection molding, these structures should be transferred to the plastic parts. So that's the idea. But there are extremely stringent requirements because we need a very high aspect ratio on the mold, a high transfer rate, which is material dependent, and we need a high durability. So at least 1 million molding cycles are required, otherwise it's not interesting for industry. And the good news is that we could develop our technology so that all these requirements can be fulfilled, and that we can obtain the required structure quality, so that again, in collaboration with this company, we can now write with our laser technology the diffractive features on molds. And these structures can be nicely transferred to the plastic parts, and so they are responsible for the market technology that's going on. And now I'm turning to the last application of this technology in medical science. This would be the application of periodic nanostructures on trauma implants. Trauma implants are such plates that come into play after an injury. If you break your bone, then they are fixed usually when such a plane is introduced in the body. And this should not stay there in the body forever, so only temporarily. This is removed after a few months or a year if reconstruction of the bone is completed. But there is a huge problem. The problem is that the implant removal is associated with complications, serious complications. They do soft tissue or nerve injury or impaired wound healing and evidently higher clinical costs. And therefore, there is a need to look at alternatives. So how can we reduce these risks? Or how can we make these implants or modify them so that it's easier to take it out of the body? So just to give you an impression of how difficult it can be to remove such an implant, this video shows you that. So is that the bone cells, the adhesion of the bone cells is too strong, and therefore it's extremely difficult to remove. But the good news is, with our technology, we could identify a topology and design these structures in a way that we can strongly reduce the ingrowth and the adhesion of osteoblasts, these are bone cells, actually, on these medical plates. And this picture shows you the original surface of the implant covered by bone cells. And this zone, this is what was treated with our laser technology, and then it's quite evident that there is a dramatic reduction of the ingrowth of bone cells. So that there is a good hope for this cell growth engineering business that clinical trials will prove the technology, and then we can go on with that, and hopefully the removal of such implants in the future will be much easier than before. And, so I'd like to summarize all that. I showed you at the beginning that it's possible to break the diffraction limit of optical microscopes, and then to obtain images with improved resolution down to about 10 nanometers. Then I also showed you that it's possible to record the face front of beams with generated by optics of high power beams with an unprecedented precision, and also laser-induced plasma source can be used for these metrology purposes to characterize optics and beams. Then I showed you the activities, or reported on the activities of photonic sensor technologies. The combustion diagnostics is performed, and the diagnostics of drinking water for drugs. And eventually I showed you